Welcome into the show. We are so excited to have Mike Michalowicz.
I'm here. Thank you guys for having me. If only viewers knew this was the second take of that.
No, they do know.
They've seen us on Facebook Live do these a couple of times, and they're like, yeah, these guys, they really suck at intros.
That was a good intro.
It's a gift.
Well, it is a real pleasure to have you on the show, Mike. I mean, Joey and I, we love books, and we get, you know, recommended books all the time, and hence the reason why we read very few, because then it's kind of like overload. Which one do you start with first?
Yeah.
Your book, though, has been recommended to us 4 or 5 times from different people all across the country, and so I decided, all right, I'm going to buy it, and thankfully, I bought the audiobook, and to me, it just, it was on point. Like, your reading of that book was the best reading of any book that I've ever heard.
You're the man. Thank you. Now, that's an awesome intro. Thank you, brother. I appreciate it. And I'm a big believer in reading my own books, specifically because I know why I wrote certain things. And when I read, I can, you know, do the right emphasis based upon that, but also reflect back and share additional stories that have come up since the publication of the book. So.
Now, that was the best part too. Like, you would add in things I could tell that weren't in the book.
Oh, yeah, totally.
Yeah, it helped us be like in the moment with you.
Yeah. Oh, that's cool. Thanks for saying that.
Now, of course, we're talking about profit first. And what business owner right now is not excited about that title? I mean, who doesn't want profit first? It seems like this elusive thing, profit. And why couldn't I get it today? Right. So everybody should be excited about this interview.
Yeah, you think everyone should be, I think, but I do have the haters that say, oh, are all you care about is money? Like, you know, oh, profit first. Isn't it people first? Isn't it? And I'm like, you don't understand the concept. If you don't have the foundation of profit, you have nothing. Like, without any profit, you'll lose your people. You'll lose everything you have. You need to focus on that foundationally. I'm not saying you're this evil money grubber. That's not what it's about. But it is about taking care of that fundamental, the lifeblood of a business, which is profit.
No, at the end of the day, we're all, if we've made a transition into being a business owner, there's only a couple motivations that really get you there. One, you do feel like you have a service or something that is of value that maybe you want to do in a unique way. But it all has to come back to, I'm creating value somewhere else as an employee. And I know that there's profit that I could be enjoying as a business owner. So let's hang a shingle. Let's go out there and start this business. But then what happens? Like, what's standing in our way of getting to that profit?
Yeah. And here's the great irony is I researched out a countless number of businesses when writing this book, and also have gone through this experience myself. It's almost uncanny how many businesses, the income is increasing over time. We're always trying to push for sales. Always trying to grow the business, but it's almost uncanny how expenses grow at almost the identical rate. And you have a big pop in sales one day, and surprisingly, all that money that came in vanishes as you spend all these different things. And the reason is that profit is the last consideration. Mm. If you look at traditional accounting, they call GAAP accounting, generally accepted accounting principles. The formula, the foundational formula of accounting, is that sales minus expenses results in profit. That's the formula. And what I found is, while that logically makes sense, behaviorally, it's fundamentally flawed. Because what it's telling us is what's important, what comes first, is sales and expenses. Now, we don't, owners only say, oh, I like to make money and spend money. Owners like to say, I like to make money and grow, instead of saying expenses. So, you know, we invest or plow back. But what we focus on is selling as much as we can, and then using money to hopefully facilitate more sales. And behaviorally, because profit comes last, it's literally the last consideration. It rarely happens. In fact, many entrepreneurs don't even consider profit until the end of the quarter, or some don't even wait until the end of the year. They look at their tax return and said, oh, no profit, maybe next year. And they kick the can of profit down the road for 365 days. So my concept is, we've got to flip that formula. It's now sales minus profit equals expenses. We take our profit first, take it immediately, and then our business will tell us what is truly available to operate on.
Well, and I know we're going to get into kind of those core principles of profit first. And that's one of them, kind of what you're referring to, that primacy effect. Our brain is definitely going to focus on things we tell it's important, right?
And right. Like
you, what you're saying is, if we actually put that as a mechanism that's at the very beginning, and I heard you say in there, like, that concept of, well, if I take profit, then my business might grow. And I know that that's an internal conversation that us entrepreneurs have all the time, right? It's this grow, grow, grow mentality. And yeah. So, you know, yeah, I got to plow that money back in, or I got to reinvest it, or whatever right. terminology they use as an excuse. But in your book, you say those are really just excuses. Those are expenses.
Excuses. And here's the most bizarre experience. We have well over 100,000 companies running profit first, over 4,000 documented case studies. And here's what's blown me away. Businesses that take their profit first consistently are outgrowing their industry competitors. They're growing faster than the industry average, which made no sense to me, because if there's less money to operate your business, how can you grow faster? But what I found is when businesses take their profit first, remove it from their business, now they have to focus on the products or services they offer that are truly the profitable ones. A lot of businesses sell stuff that actually isn't profitable, you know, that superfluous products. They have to remove that because there's not enough money now to support the stuff that's not working. And when you focus on the products and services that are most profitable, you also have to then focus on the clients that want to consume that, your best clients. So it forces actually more of a niche specialization inherently. Better products selling to better customers, and you start focusing on that community. That community, because you're focusing on them now, raves about you, talks about you. You start expanding the awareness of you starts expanding that community, and growth takes off. It's almost uncanny how frequently it happens that when businesses start focusing on profit, that it actually facilitates faster growth because it focuses on the healthy growth.
Right. No, I mean, we always say the riches in the niches, right? It comes back to focusing in that Pareto principle where, you know, 20% of your customer base is going to produce 80% of the results, but yet we want to have these great businesses and our big businesses just so that we can have that esteem that we can show off, but that's not what actually is putting profit in our pocket. So diving into this, what do you believe, if we haven't already touched on it, is the biggest problem keeping business owners from being profitable?
So it's really the mindset of profit is an event. Mm. So, and people say that, I mean, they don't say, hey, listen, profit will happen as an event. They'll say, I'll be profitable one day. And they look for these trigger moments like, oh, I'll have that big client. Once we land that big client, we get one more client, we'll break into profitability. Or if that one investor swoops in, you know, and buys our organization, that's where we're gonna make our money. So entrepreneurs think profit is an event. And it's not. Profit is not an event. Profit is a habit. It needs to be baked into every single transaction. Profit occurs from making pennies every minute, not $1 million one day down the road, because that one day never comes. That's the mindset shift. And the profit first system makes it practical. Every single time there's a transaction, you're immediately taking out profit, plus other elements, but you're taking out profit to ensure that profit is secured, and then you know what you have to run the business.
Yeah, Russ and I were actually talking about, that's great, thank you for sharing that, ahead of time, okay, what is it more behavioral things that we see as the biggest challenge, or is it more things that are, I don't know even what the word I'm looking for.
Like, but unnecessary expenses, overspending maybe.
Yeah, it is unnecessary expenses, but it's all rooted in behavioral psychology. So, you guys saw the books I have, Marketing Myself, behind me, but above it are the more important ones. Those are all books on behavioral psychology or an influence and persuasion and mind operations and psychology. It's a side passion of mine. And what I've discovered in my own readings and research and just practical experience is that humans, we are in behavioral patterns that we follow. Even though we know there's a different, perhaps better way, we fall back into a pattern. When it comes to money, as an entrepreneur, for example, my accountant, his name is Keith, he talks till he's blue in the face. He's like, Mike, read your income statement, your balance sheet, your cash flow statement, run these different metrics, know certain critical things like the OCR, which is the operating cash ratio, all these things. He goes, do all that. And he goes, whatever you do, Mike, never log into your bank account because that's not reflective of your business. And if you run off these statements, we can have a healthy business. But you know, that's great for Spock, but, you know, but not for me.
Right.
So what do? I log into my bank account and I trust my gut. If I see money in my account, I'm like, thank God, I have something I can spend. I can invest or do things. And if there's no money, then it's like, oh my gosh, I got to sell something to somebody immediately. Panic ensues.
Yeah.
What I found is my behavior is to revert to bank balance accounting, see how much money I have. And what I've found through all my research is changing your behavior, our own behavior, is very hard, near impossible. So instead of trying to adjust and change who I am, instead change the system to capture what you already do, but now channel to the outcome you want. So the challenge is behavior, getting back to your original question. Money management is a behavioral problem. Profit is a behavioral problem. the solution, there's a logical solution to it, traditional accounting, it works, but it fails the 99% of entrepreneurs who are emotionally driven. We're great salespersons. We're very persuasive. We're very enthusiastic and believe in our stuff. We're not number crunchers. Well, those people who revert to bank balance accounting, we simply need a system that channels us to the outcome we want. And that's why I developed Profit First. Nothing about us needs to change. In fact, we need to do some of those bad habits more frequently now, and we'll make more profit as a result.
All right. So as we start diving into kind of nuts and bolts, we're going to need to understand where we are, right? I mean, you don't know where you're going. Like the idea of GPS, it has to start with where you are.
Right.
You got to put in a destination, but the first thing is like tracking, like you're here.
Yeah. So, location. Yeah.
In your eyes, what is the starting point for someone?
Well, so in the book, we do this thing called an instant assessment. And the instant assessment is a quick way of analyzing historically how much profit you've been allocating, how much money you've been earning for yourself, how much taxes have been being paid. There's actually five buckets we analyze. And what I found for most businesses is they don't have any historical or very little historical profit. So anyone that's watching and says, oh, I never really have a bonus check at the end of the year or every quarter, I don't get a bonus check. That means you don't have profit. And I want to be very clear. Profit can be defined two ways. There's a accountant's definition of profit. That's where at the end of the year, they circle numbers like, oh, congratulations, 20 grand in the circle. And you're like, oh, where's the money? You're like, oh, you don't have that money. You spent that. That's called an accounting profit. I'm not talking about that profit. To me, that's not profit at all. Profit is a cash, cold, hard cash bonus at the end of every quarter going to you. Every 90 days, I'm writing you a check above and beyond the compensation you're taking as an owner. That's what profit is. So we look and say, historically, have you taken bonus checks beyond regular distributions to support your lifestyle? For most businesses, it's no, zero profit. So we said, okay, that's our starting point. Most owners take income from their business as distributions. If they have an S corp or C corp, it'll be a paycheck. But they take it sometimes sporadically. They're usually the last one to get paid. You know, pay my best employees, pay the rent, pay everything. If there's any money left, I'll pay me. Which the great irony is usually in most businesses, the best employees, the owners, you guys, like no one loves the business, cares for it as much as you do, or will work as hard for it. Yeah. So we look at your pay. Taxes. This one, so rarely does our taxes ever addressed by the business. It's always the owner. You know, my personal income tax comes. I'm like, I guess I'm personally responsible. Well, a business can legally pay your taxes, and I don't care about the formation. It can be an S corp, C corp, LLC, hybrid, sole proprietorship, LLP. I don't care. There's a way for the business to pay the taxes for the owner, to reserve that money, and then an accountant will tell you exactly how to do it, but reserve that money. So we're going to say, how much did your business pay for your taxes? And usually that's zero also. So we figure that, and then how much money was for operating expenses. Once we know where you've been historically, we then determine, using that GPS model, the destination you want to get to.
Yes.
Then we figure out the path to navigate to get there.
So, Russ, did you send him our assessment ahead of time? I don't remember.
Was he describing it to you? Is that what you thought, Stallion?
Yeah. I it was horrible, guys. No, I did not see it.
And by the way, write this down. I am the best employee here, Russ. Okay. Just
yes.
There you go.
Done. You really there are.
Mike said it. Okay.
No doubt. And we're going to get into that because you talk about that in your book, who is the best employee? And by the way, I tricked my wife by asking her that question and completely got her off guard. But so here's the thing with this instant assessment. By the way, we're going to have a link in the show notes. You're going to be able to get access to all of these tools. Mike's been so gracious to pull all these things together and allows you to be able to do these things. And so the Sally and I sat down, we put our business into this. And we were running through, like, we thought, Mike, like, look, hey, we've been doing great. I mean, we really have been crushing it. Like, this is going to be one of those things where it's going to be like, it's going to be more like a pat on the back. Like, congratulations, guys. You guys are just knocking this out of the park. And we got down to that operating expense revenue line and compared it to what the business should have.
Yeah.
It was only $84,000 off.
Yeah.
How was $84,000 off?
Just $84,000. Yeah.
Out of what kind of revenue, though? Because if that's $100 million in revenue, you're close. If it's $1 million of revenue, that's, we got something to fix.
We're just shy of $100 million.
Just a tiny bit.
You're doing perfectly.
When you said 40%, we were at 65%.
Okay. Oh shit, we got something correct. So let me tell you about those numbers. Like, our company did research of about 1,000 companies, industry agnostic. We literally looked at pizza shops and accounting firms to wealth management to retail stores, professional services. And what we looked at was for the fiscally elite, meaning we wanted to find the companies that were blowing away the industry averages and said, what were their numbers? And that's the aggregate of the fiscally elite. I fully expect for 95% of the readers, because only 5% of companies are the fiscally elite, for 95% of readers, they're not going to be close to those numbers. But we can achieve those. And I think any business can achieve those numbers of the fiscally elite. We just need to look at our business through a new lens like you guys are now.
Well, I can tell you, we sat down, we broke that thing out. So we pulled out QuickBooks, right, and he and I are sitting there just devouring these numbers, trying to figure out, okay, where do you cut 84,000? Like, where does that come from?
Yeah.
And it's like, we need to hire two more people around this place. Yeah, is what we've been telling ourselves for the last 6 months. And it's like, oh, well, that we're not going to be doing that. So I wonder, is this like a big challenge that as you're coaching people and you've had people, obviously you spoke all over the world. Is that one of those big conversations? People are like, I don't know where we're going to get this money. How am I going to
these
boxes?
Yeah. You know, I think it was a Stallion there who talked about the Pareto principle, the 80-20 rule. You know, I think profit, I know this, profit, maybe 10 to 20% of profit comes from cost cutting. The 80 to 90% comes from margin. Mm-hmm. So you can't cut your way to a healthy business, but you can you can cut away the fat, right? But you can't cut into the muscle. So I would look at your business and say, can we cut costs by 10% or maybe even 20% and do some aggressive stuff? More importantly, I'd say, how do we increase margins? How do we dictate a bigger premium? What are our best-selling products? How do we focus more on those? So most businesses that go through profit first, the quick, easy thing is cutting costs. We can do that overnight and get some jump on profit. That makes people feel good. The next stage, which is longer, is increasing that margin.
Okay, because that's good to hear, because immediately, you know, Russ and I are the forever optimists.
Yeah.
And so we're like, oh, that just means we have to increase sales. Like, that's no big deal.
Yeah.
Like, of course. I mean, we can get to that margin, no problem. But then we were like, but wait a minute, are we falling into that same idea he talks about in the book? Like, just sell more and not worry about cutting costs? And it seems like it is a balance.
Increase sales volume on profitable products.
Yeah.
And not increase your overhead whatsoever, or even start reducing a little bit as you're growing. That's a beautiful scenario, actually.
Well, and I kind of think that leads into where we really started taking your book and started applying it to what we do and how we help coach our clients through different things. Because our clients are struggling to reach financial independence. That's the reason they came to us. Yep. And they follow this typical model that is out there that you're supposed to give your money away and hope that it comes back, right? So we believe, no, it starts with us. We're our best asset. We're our businesses are our best investment. And we're going to teach people to not plow back in, but reinvest, invest in yourself, take profit out now that with your concept, but do those things and then start looking for outside things once we're at that point. But we noticed that, you know, our typical client is setting up insurance policies. We kind of talked about that pre-show where they set these up, and these are some of their vault strategies, as you talk about in the book. These are some of those accounts that are hold long-term profit, things that they can use for other investment opportunities down the road. But one of the things that we notice is that they're giving us a fixed amount of money. It's not a percentage. And so there's an area there that we were like, you know, we have clients that have been with us for 10 years and they started out giving us $50,000 a year. Maybe they were making a couple hundred thousand at that point. Well, now they're making $300,000-$400,000. But yet it's still 50,000.
Interesting.
Like, yeah. And it's like, I when I sit down and I go, what do you think's happened with that difference? Maybe they're putting it somewhere else, but my assumption is probably reality is it's being spent.
Yeah. That's going right out the window, I'm sure. Yeah. And that was one of the key things about Profit First is a percentage-based systems. So, you know, people ask me, I'm just starting a brand new business. I have $0 in revenue. What point do I need to be at before I can implement Profit First? I said, you're at the point. You don't need any revenue, because if you take in $0, those percentages still work. You just put 0% into each account. But the second you take a dollar, you can take 10% or whatever the number is, you know, 10 cents and move into an account. And the reason we want to get this started immediately, regardless of the size of the business, is you start buying into the system. You start seeing the impact it has. And to your point, Russ, as the business grows in revenue, your allocations, the portions, while the percentages stay the same, the apportionment, of course, grows too because of the greater top line. So it's a dynamic system. It works with the ebbs and flows of sales.
Well, we know that those who listen to this book are going to be forever impacted. It's going to help them. I work with a lot of people in the medical field. They get no business skills at all, but yet they come out of these residency programs and they're immediately thrust into business ownership roles.
Right.
I mean, I talk to them and I say, you know, what's the biggest challenge you face? And they're like, running the business.
Yeah.
And they don't have no clue, yet they're looked upon as the experts by those around them because they make money. So clearly they must understand what money looks like. So I love the way this book is going to do that. I know Joey and I are going to be creating webinars to show them how to use these same concepts that we've been doing and attaching those into it. So, all right. So I want to get in and dive into kind of the practical application here. So the four core principles of profit first. So the first one, and I love this analogy, small plates. Tell
small
us
what plates. Yeah. So this, I look for parallels in life, outside of financials in this case, and then translate them in. And I found diets actually, a good diet will translate into a good financial discipline. And what I found was this fitness instructor explained that in the American diet, actually this is true globally too, plates have doubled in size. So 300 years ago, what we considered a coffee saucer or a dessert plate was what George Washington and his buddies were eating off of. And they followed the exact same behavioral pattern. Fill up your plate, clean off your plate. Well, plates have doubled in size. So what happens is we still follow the same behavioral pattern. We fill up the plate and we still clean off the plate. But since the plate has doubled in size, the portions have doubled in size, the caloric intake has doubled in size, and our waistlines have doubled in size. So in business, what I found is most businesses, if we had a chance to query the people listening in, and I asked them, like, how many bank accounts do you have for your business? Most I find will say, oh, I have one, maybe two bank accounts. One big plate, and all the money for the business goes in there, and they look at that one big plate, and then they spend from that plate. They log into their bank account and say, oh, I got X number of dollars on that plate. Let me spend it. But that's basically filling up a plate and then eating everything that's off of it. What we need to do is carve it up into what I call small plates. And as of this recording, Thanksgiving just passed just a few weeks ago. And
yes,
what happened in my house and happens everywhere is, you know, there's a serving tray of turkey, but you don't tell your guests, hey, everyone, grab a knife and fork, fight for it. Eat off the serving tray. You apportion it to each guest so everyone can eat. And that's the concept we're going to do here. Instead of having one account, I believe there's five foundational accounts for every business. As you grow, there's actually more accounts. But the accounts are this. Income, that's the serving tray. You never eat off of it. Profit, that's a small plate that we're going to allocate a percentage of that income to. Owner's compensation, the most important employees. If we don't pay the owners adequately and appropriately, resentment will kick in. There's a day, as an owner of my own businesses, that I said, I F this, I'm paying everyone else. I refinanced my house to pay payroll. I'm protecting everyone. I hate my company and I hate everybody. Mm-hmm. So that's got to stop today. We got to pay the owner a salary. Profit and owner's comp is different. Owner's comp is paying you for your function as an employee. Profit is a distribution for being a shareholder, a massive risk taker. You founded the business or invested in it. Third or fourth account is the tax account. We talked about that earlier, to pay your personal taxes. The fifth account is operating expenses. And what we do with these plates is we allocate a percentage to each. You can download it from the instant assessment. There's no sign up or anything. It's just free. But you can allocate a percentage of this money to each account. And now when a deposit comes in, say $1,000, we don't look at that deposit and say, oh, I have $1,000 for my business. You don't. Portion of that goes to pay, maybe $100, or I'm sorry, goes to profit, $100 to profit, maybe $200 goes to pay, maybe $300 or $200 goes to taxes. If 200 went there and 200 and 100, now we're talking $500. So you don't have $1,000 to run your business. You have the difference, which is $500, in the operating expense to run your business. The beauty of the system is you get to continue your natural behavior. If you log into your bank account once a week or once a month or many times a day, like I do, you now see with absolute clarity what the intended use of the money is before you spend it. And that encourages you to spend it appropriately. People do try to break the system. There's ways to fix the system so it won't be broken, but that's the basic principle.
And one of the things you talked about in the book, what I really liked about it was getting all of the reoccurring and automatic drafts stopped. So that way you literally can see them when they happen.
Yeah. Yeah. Cause this is a behavioral system. We want the visceral feeling, the emotional feeling. Here's what happens. I think the owner of the business should do this for a period of time before they allocate it to a bookkeeper or someone else, because I want you to go through the emotion. The money comes in, you see in that income account. Rule is you don't touch it, you allocate it. You never spend from it. When you allocate it, you always do it in a certain sequence, which is one of the principles, by the way. Sequence is very important. You allocate to profit. You feel a reward because you're paying yourself. You allocate to owner's comp. You feel a reward. You pay it to taxes, which is a form of protection because now you're paying the government adequately and you don't have to worry about taxes anymore. And then the last part is serves the business. So it goes through a sequence of reward, protect, and serve, which is a behavioral sequence of building confidence. So you do it yourself. If this stuff is automated, it's all behind the scenes. You don't know what's going on. If you're the one who's then got to cut the checks, the bills, you'll feel that pain. And because it's cash-based, it's immediate. You know, like when you swipe a credit card, you don't feel the pain for 30 days and you're like, oh my gosh, my credit card bill. I'm not even going to open that credit card statement so I don't feel that pain. There's avoidance. Right. You know, this way, by doing it, you feel it right away. And it'll be painful in the beginning, but very quickly people adjust and start building confidence like they never had before in their ability to manage their money.
In this one area too, you talk about Parkinson's law, and our clients are really aware of this rule because this is, we have several books that we kind of recommend, and one of them, it hits Parkinson's law, and it talks about the concept of demand rising to equal supply, right? And yeah, you mentioned that with the plate of food. I mean, the Stallion is an expert at being a clean plate ranger. This guy has dominated every plate that he's ever seen. So he knows if that plate is full, like his job is not complete to clean it off.
I'm kind of a big deal, Mike. I'm just going to go ahead and say it.
Kind of a big deal. I get it.
And getting bigger by the minute as we sit around and eat.
Oh, that was a dig. Thank God you guys are in the same room, because that would have been a kick to the nuts right there.
we get I loved about the part is when you are paying these bills and you are allocating to different accounts, then you're saying, okay, I only have this left. And in your book, which by the way, we do a little R&D for a webinar that we're getting ready to do. In our world, you know, R&D means rip off and duplicate. So
I love that.
I love the video that from the Apollo 13 where they come in after the air filter had gone out. And
I was
like, that concept, and if everybody's ever watched Apollo 13, you know what we're talking about. Like whenever they needed to fix the air filter, and they had just a couple of hours and like a handful of things to do, and they go dump that stuff on the table. Well, it's literally like our brains go to thinking. We get creative. We figure out ways to make it happen.
Yes.
And so then that's where Parkinson's law is working at our benefit, right? Like the supply that we have available to us is this. And so we're going to like be really creative and going to make wiser choices with our money.
It's funny. So Parkinson flipped the traditional thinking of the economic supply and demand curve. Traditional economics teaches as demand increases, the more people want to consume something, vendors like us, people like us, will appear to service that demand. And it makes logical sense. But Parkinson proposed a reverse behavior of where as something becomes more available, the more supply is available, actually demand will increase to meet the supply. And you shared the example with food. In the book, I talk about toothpaste, how it plays out there. Apollo 13 is the same example. What was interesting with Parkinson, he says, as you restrict the supplies, less stuff is available, our demand is forced to be reduced, right? If there's less food to eat, you have to eat less. If there's less money to consume, you have to spend less. So frugality kicks in. But the interesting side benefit is innovation kicks in. We find ways to continue to extract value. So when there's less money to spend, we do spend less, but we actually start to stretch the dollar. When there's less food to eat, we actually enjoy the food more. Right. We don't wolf it down. Now we're like, we're tasting it more. And Apollo 13, I share that when I do my presentations, is that those those engineers that designed that shuttle, they spent tens of millions of dollars on the original carbon dioxide filtration system that generated oxygen. Tens of millions of dollars. When they were given no time and no resources, they were said, hey, you got 5 hours to save these astronauts that are in outer space right now, and you must make in carbon dioxide filtration system. And by the way, here's the duct tape and like toothpaste that's up there. Make it out of this. They still did it.
Yeah.
And here's what I'm not proposing, like, oh my God, they should make like rocket ships out of duct tape. But what I am suggesting is there is a far more economical solution than spending tens of millions of dollars. But since they were given tens of millions of dollars to make that one component, they spent it all. Those people, they are rocket scientists. They are very smart people. They too fall victim to Parkinson's law, increasing supply, increasing consumption. it's the natural human wiring of all of us. If we intentionally restrict the supply of money into our business, less money for operating expenses, we will sometimes blow ourselves away about how innovative we get. Mm-hmm.
Mike, we need to have you up at Capitol Hill because you know, the government is the king of providing way too much supply for other different contracts and whatnot. And it's, you know, I'm sure you listen to all of our podcast episodes, but the one on the tax train is coming is a result of that.
That was my favorite episode nightmare. Ever. ever. And I even have a tattoo. You can't see it on my back about some of the famous quotes from that one. And I'll tell you, you know, that stuff frustrates the heck out of me, that budget. Like, oh, did you spend your budget? And listen, it isn't just government. Government is moronic at times. So is big corporations. Big corporations, like, you know, did this department spend the budget? If you didn't, we're going to cut your budget. So the whole game comes about spending more money. It is ridiculous. There was one public company, and I can't disclose their name, sadly, but they implemented Profit First, and they called us. Because of Sarbanes-Oxley and all these different laws, they couldn't even call it Profit First. They had to do different implementation. But here's the essence of what they did. They would land a project, say it was a $10 million project. They would assign it to the department and project manager. Historically, they'd say, here's a $10 million project. Make us, you know, make us $1 million. Make us 10% on this profit. Now, they take out Profit First. So they get a $10 million project. They take out 20%. They say, hey, here's $8 million. And they still tell that project manager to make us 10%. And the manager does.
Yeah.
So these projects are now making $3 million on a $10 million project as opposed to $1 million, meaning they're making 30% as opposed to 10% just through one simple behavioral shift. Reduce the supply. So it works.
No, it totally works. All right. So the second core principle of Profit First is serve sequentially. What's that mean?
Yeah. So we touched on it already. And this comes out of another fitness principle. Is that when you serve all food simultaneously, and that's how most food is served. Next time you go out to lunch or dinner, whatever you order, the vegetables, the meat, the potatoes are all served simultaneously. And the problem is we will then default to what we prefer. Listen, I know vegetables are so important for our diet. I'm not a big vegetable guy. I'll go after the meat and potatoes. And that's the problem. I'm not getting the fiber or nutrients or any of that stuff. And everyone knows this. But sadly, for most Americans, this is true globally too, most people don't eat enough vegetables. And you can go outside of any restaurant anywhere in the world and look at the dumpster. They're throwing out more vegetables than any other food item. So what's the problem? Well, this fitness instructor explained, if you simply serve vegetables first and nothing else, we will actually eat more vegetables because there's nothing else. So the sequence of how we offer things will bring about the moderate consumption of everything. Because now I'll eat my vegetables. Now, when you serve the meat and potatoes, I actually ate some already. I'll eat less of that. So balance comes about. When it comes to the allocation of money, some people hear this Profit First system and say, oh, okay, $1,000 comes in. I'm going to allocate based upon percentages. Let me just put money into the operating expenses and see how I'm doing. That's not the way to do it. You have to always go in a sequence because we need that reward mechanism. The vegetables equivalent for business is profit. So when that money comes in, the first thing we always do is allocate profit. We then actually hide the money from ourselves. And that's another principle I share. Then we allocate money to pay ourselves. It's that, as I said earlier, the reward and the reward. By doing those two reward distributions or allocations first, you'll feel confidence. Then we reserve money for taxes, protection. The final thing we do is fund the operating expense account. And while I realize it's the same percentages, going through the sequence triggers the endorphin release that we're like building confidence around this. If money goes into operating expense and then you sit there and say, let me see how much money is left after I spend these bills. Maybe I need to take a little more. That defeats the system. So you always have to do that profit, or reward, I should say.
Isn't it though funny that in that analogy, you talk about profit and owner's comp being the vegetables, but yet isn't that what should be the dessert? Isn't that the chocolate souffle that we want to eat, but we don't, because we literally will pay ourselves last. You, in the book, you say that Joey is the best employee and he was like taking credit for that. And you say that because why?
Yeah. So, let me just go through the chocolate souffle. I think it's actually really taxes. It's empty calories, right? Yeah. Profit is the substance of your business. If you don't have it, here's what I know is going to happen. It's only a matter of time before resentment kicks in. Like, gosh, I'm not getting anything out of this business. I start hating my business. And then the day comes, you may have to shutter the doors or that financial heart attack where you got to fire off half your staff. So the substance, the the real vitamins for companies, profitability. So much so that I would argue your clients want you to be profitable. In fact, I would argue they want you to be wildly profitable. Now, they'll never say that. No client will ever say to you, hey, Russ, can we pay you a little extra money? Why don't you rip us off? No client will ever say that. But no client will either say this, hey, I hope you're making nothing and you go out of business tomorrow after I just paid you money. No, right. They want your presence. Every client wants to know that if they pay you, that you're going to return the value that they've invested in you. Secondly, that you're going to be around,
right,
and that you're not distracted. And if we're not taking profit, which I consider the vegetables, I know best case, you're distracted. You're like, oh my gosh, how am I going to make money? And you can't focus on me, your customer. And worst case, you're going to be shuttering the doors. So that's why I consider it the vegetables.
Well, no, it's again, I think that, and I like vegetables. Joey likes chocolate souffle. So, and I would say at the level that he eats it, it's not empty calories because he's putting enough of those in there.
He's stacking them. He's hitting the nuts again.
And I ate a smoothie for lunch. I don't even want to hear this crap.
Nice.
he ate a smoothie for lunch at like just fighting me the whole way. Can we get a hamburger to go with this thing? All right. So the third principle is remove temptation. So we've got to get that chocolate ice cream shake out of Joey's face, right?
Yeah.
How does that translate into money?
So my weakness is Twizzlers. Like I cannot resist them. I found that when we try to resist temptation with willpower, if willpower fatigues like a muscle, I don't care what it is, you may say no to it initially, and then you're like, well, just a little bite, never hurt anyone, and you're all over it. the only way to prevent temptation is to never have it accessible. If there's no Twizzlers, I can't eat them. They're not available. Same thing with money. When we put money in that profit account, if it stays with your bank that you're working with, and you can't pay your bills, temptation sets in. Now, the lesson is when you can't pay your bills, your business is telling you you can't afford those bills. We need to cut costs, increase margin, right? But the easy thing is that quick hit of, I'll just borrow from the profit account. You borrow from the profit account, you unwind the entire system. So what we need to do here is transfer that money to a secondary bank. And the whole goal here is to make it inconvenient. We're off the air. We're talking about the drive of shame.
Yeah.
Like get this at a bank where it's depository only, no online banking, no starter checks, no freaking no ATM card. It's outside, out of mind, and it's very hard to withdraw that money. And there's mechanisms to make it difficult to withdraw. Once that money's out of sight, out of mind, you're forced to work it within the confines of your operating expenses, which you should be anyway, but now you're not tempted.
Yeah, and we actually talked about it a little bit ahead of time, but it's not necessarily as hard as you're making it out to be, but a lot of the time our clients are using these cash value life insurance policies to replace that profit, that long-term place that they can still get access to, but it's not going to be as easy as a swipe on their smartphone.
Exactly. And you know, the goal here is just to give people pause. Like if it's in that life insurance policy, I got to think long and hard about it. I make a call. I got to explain myself to someone. Why am I doing this? It may be too much of a headache. And that's what I want. I want real hard thought going into it before you borrow from yourself, which means stealing from yourself. I want entrepreneurs to focus on operating expenses and say, how do I make this work? How do I increase margin? How do I cut costs? We got to keep asking those questions.
And if you're following this process, and that's the thing, is changing that behavior, creating a system that you know, kind of runs parallel with your behavior, then you have a process. So if you are growing, and like you said, if there's, you know, we use like an old economic principle called economic value added, right? So if like Coca-Cola, Briggs & Stratton Railroad, all these different, not Briggs & Stratton, Briggs and Stratton and CSS Railroad would use dollars before they would start up a new enterprise. Even if it was cash, they literally would do the math and figure out what is the profit margin going to be on that? Because it's easy. If you just throw cash in it, you don't understand, well, was that a profitable?
You don't assign the value of it. Yeah.
Yeah.
And so for us, we know that if we are assigning value and you have a system like this that allows us to have percentages, then we know if we're falling within the allotted range.
Yeah. Yeah. You can, when starting a new business, I think we need to project what we're doing, and then profit first gives us the day-to-day accountability to it. Yeah. So, you know, I can't tell you how many business plans I've looked at that, they look amazing on paper, but there's not an ounce of reality in it. Like, oh, you know, if we keep doing this process for 5 years, we'll be a $1 billion company. It's like, really, really? You'll be a $1 billion company. Oh yeah. And the profit, it'll throw off so much profit. And I say, okay, if you really believe this is true, let's set those profit numbers and let's do all those things from day one and see how you're consistent with it, how consistent you are with it. And within a week, they're like, not even close. So we need to be realistic in our projections, but then we need to have a system that holds us accountable to those projections throughout.
That's part of your last step in the four core principles, was kind of enforcing a rhythm, having a process that you follow on a regular basis. Like the 10th and 25th is one that you mentioned in the book.
Yeah. So we have this thing called the 10-25 rule. And basically, you don't do this allocation stuff impromptu, meaning a deposit comes in, you immediately allocate it. That can get very arduous. Instead, allow the money to accumulate on that profit in that income account. It's a turkey. It's a cash turkey. And let it build up. And then on the 10th, carve it up fully, allocate it, and then let it accumulate again. And by doing this, you'll see how your business breathes income. And there's more to it. You can actually see cash flow patterns just by logging into your bank account. So you get to continue to do your natural behavior. The reason we do 10th, 25th too, is when you allocate that money out, money hits the operating expense account, you pay bills, you'll pay those bills on the 10th, what's available in there, and it'll go out and arrive at your vendors by the 15th. When you do it on the 25th, it arrives by end of month. That's usually when bills are due. So it gets you in a rhythm also with your vendors. But there's another component, we call it the 90-day rhythm, is that every 90 days, you will go to that profit account you've been accumulating and take a percentage of it out. Usually we suggest 50%. So if I squirreled away, $10,000, I'm gonna take out a $5,000 check. Now, when you start Profit First, I've been doing this, by the way, I'm approaching my ninth year, so it's 33 quarters. I've had 33 or 34 consecutive quarters of profit. The first time I had a profit distribution, it was like $6. It wasn't like, but listen, the company sent me to Starbucks. It was $6 in hand, and the company paid for it. It was the best cup of coffee I've had in my life. Now that money's grown, and it's substantial. And I'm doing things in my personal life with that money to celebrate, to enjoy it, to save, to pay college. But I'm using it to benefit myself. That's the rule when profit comes out. It's a celebratory account. It never goes back into the business, because if you put it back in the business, it's never really a profit. It's an expense, and you're unwinding the system.
No, I love it. Well, I know that we've gone a little long here. We really appreciate you going through this book. The Stallion and I are going to do some webinar on this. We'll forward you some of that content, get your opinion on the areas that we can improve upon it, because we believe in your system.
Thanks,
we love your book, and you've got some other tools out there that people need to know about. So kind of help our listeners know, like, how does Mike Michalowicz make money, and how can they reach out to you and get access to your other stuff?
Yeah, so shockingly, I make money as an author. That's my passion. So, and you can see I have strategically all my books positioned there, but you can check out my books and explore them by going to my website, which is Mike Michalowicz. Here's the shortcut though. No one knows how to spell Michalowicz. It's long, it's Polish, it's ugly. I get it. You can go to Mike Motorbike. That was my nickname in high school, Mike Motorbike. Go to MikeMotorbike.com, and my books are there. I used to write for the Wall Street Journal. You can get articles from there. And I'm a podcaster and blogger too, so you can check that stuff out.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for being on our show. We really appreciate you and everything you're doing for the business community, because we need that for sure.
Russ, thank you. Stallion, thank you.
Have a blessed holiday.
Yeah, you too. Take care, y'all.
All right, see you.